How's everybody?
Bless.
Always.
We are still in the book of Proverbs. Somebody tell me who wrote the book?
Solomon.
Who did it?
Solomon.
Solomon, son of King David. And a lot of his advice that Solomon the child received and grew up with comes straight from his parents. Primarily his mother. Who was that? Who?
Bathsheba.
Y'all knew that, right?
Oh, yes.
It was an Ann Landis.
Now, the first son died.
Yeah. First son died?
Yeah. The one that was
legitimate. Yes.
Right.
He died.
Yep.
So Bathsheba can speak from a position of what?
I guess you could say authority.
You say experience?
Yeah.
Speak from a position of experience. The question to the class, is that the best teacher?
Not the best teacher, but it's a teacher. You say, is it the best or is it a teacher? Which one did you say?
Is that the best teacher? Someone I've heard before, experience is the best.
Where you get that? That's an adage.
Is that true? What's the best teacher?
Well,
the
word.
Okay.
The word is the best teacher. Experience
else?
Is effective.
Anybody else? I'm here. Everybody agree? Yes. The word is the best
word.
Yeah, teacher.
It's
good. Experience is effective. I can tell you that.
I would say,
the word is
only, yeah, the word, experience. The word is the best teacher.
It is, it's effective, I said sometimes.
Don't do that again, won't go over there again.
Personality.
Yeah, but most people don't.
Express a lot of stuff and just keep doing the same.
Keep doing the same thing.
They haven't learned. All right, so we're going to continue on with this, and tonight and today it's us talking about, you know, wisdom and application of wisdom and application of getting the mind of God. And we should, before I start off, the author of our lesson had a challenging sentence to me, and I thought maybe I would put that out first. He said, I don't know if it's in your study or not, but this sentence at the end of a paragraph is this, is that, let's see. Our lesson begins with the contrast between God and the king. The glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out matter. Search out matter. God is transcendent, and his glory arises from the fact that much about him is veiled from us. And I had a disagreement with that. There is much about his redemptive and creative work that we cannot understand. That's what the author said. I don't know if you guys got that paragraph or not.
Mm-hmm.
Do you?
Yeah.
Do you? Okay. So Brother Williams is, I don't buy into everything I read. I won't buy into that. But how do you guys feel about that? There's much about God that is veiled, which is hidden. And what really got to me is there is much about his creative and redemptive work that we cannot understand. Coffee and donuts for the first comment.
All right, I'm a little hungry, so I always started in this fashion. Even though we can see a lot that God has done and created, I always thought that, I just always felt, for no reason other than just feeling this way, is that just that there is a lot that we do not know about him, or what his intents or thoughts or beliefs, ideas, and all of that is. Because it tells us that his thinking is much higher than ours. So in that regard, I feel that there is probably, perhaps, a lot that we don't know about him. And what we don't know, we don't know.
I'm with Brother Rod there. I think the author, I think the way he put it made it sound like you just can't grasp hold of anything or the reality of his redemption. And that's not true, but Romans 11:33?
We'll get there in a minute. That's part of this.
Oh, is it?
I'm still my
yeah, it's in there.
I'm still
right
my
Right there.
Go ahead.
But it says his ways are past finding out. I think sometimes his
definitely want to hit that. Catch it.
His thoughts are so much higher than ours. And especially if we're coming from a human standpoint, not letting our spirits communicate,
okay.
our natural mind can grasp total hold of it.
One more comment, because you guys are trying to steal my thunder. Who else? That's good for you.
I just want my donut and coffee.
Okay. Meet me at Panera Bread in the morning, 8:00. I'll buy you a pastry. Okay, here's the deal. Okay. Solomon wrote this book of Proverbs, and what we do study, as new covenant believers, we do study and take heed of what Solomon said. Solomon was a Old Testament what? Person, character. No, I have to say believer, Old Testament character. And so his belief had a limit on it. Also his understanding had a limit on it. So therefore he told us the best that he could. Even Bathsheba told him the best that he could, that they could. And with the best that Solomon had, you see how well he did. That he had at the time. But we got something a whole lot better than what Solomon or anybody else back then had. And some of the things that where they could not go past, we have quantum leap past those realities. But you have to understand your existence today in the light of your redemption. Because we don't want to be new covenant redeemed by God believers with an old covenant mindset and understanding. Because a lot of folks exist in that way and they are short-circuiting themselves under the new covenant realities. Let's go gather up, get some coffee and donuts.
All right.
So let me go back and read what the Solomon. No short circuit myself.
Also with the Old Testament believers, they got all their information secondhand, pretty much, because they couldn't even come into the presence of God.
We'll put out New Testament scriptures to identify what I'm talking about. So as we study this, and as you do study an Old Testament book, you got to study it from the reality that you are redeemed. You're not in the same position that they are in when they wrote what they wrote. I do believe all 66 books of the Bible, but I do not believe that all 66 of the Bible is going to get me where I want to go under this new covenant. Don't y'all throw nothing up here, Williams. What did he just say? All 66 of them won't get me where I want to go.
So you mean if I catch a woman cheating with a man, I can't know him?
How many minutes did you catch him with Sister
Gabriel?
Let's see here. So, you know, not to get so technical, but we operate under another covenant. So even though we're going to read this book, the wisdom that Solomon had, and he had stuff going on that nobody has matched. It's not too many people have matched. But we understand that he's doing it with limited ability. Limited. If he can do it with limited ability and resources, what should we be doing when we got the whole thing?
But we have to, I think one thing, a point we want to remember is that whereas we're operating under a different covenant, we too have limited abilities because God's ways are so, we're operating in the finite and he is infinite. So there's still things that we don't understand. Redemptive, yes, we do. But there's still a realm of our, that we just still don't understand. We see through a glass darkly.
Okay.
Still, we don't.
Especially the last part.
We do.
I agree with this, especially the last. Okay, here we go, Proverbs 25:1, let's see some realities. Someone read that if you will, verse 1 and 2, chapter 25 of Proverbs.
These are also Proverbs of Solomon, which the men of Hezekiah, king of Judah, copied out.
Right, that's what, but that is saying there is that Solomon gave the right to copyright. He relinquished his copyright, same thing he had written. And say, Hezekiah, you and your boys copied again so he'd be preserved. That's what he did. Same thing we do today.
It is the glory of God to conceal a thing, but the honor of kings is to search out a man.
Okay, all right. It is the glory of God to conceal a thing. And this is what he said, and that's so true back in his day. It was so right for God to show all that he is to by hiding stuff from us to show that you ain't got it. I'm the one that's got it all. You don't have it all. Knowledge, wisdom, understanding, all that kind of stuff. So that's what the scripture's saying. But the honor of kings is to search out what?
A man.
A man. Okay, so that means that the king, in his finite existence and understanding, will have to do all that he could to search and get the answer. Even though he had a high position in life as a king, he had to go far and wide. Like the Candace, queen of Ethiopia, she came to, who was that? David, to get some answers.
Solomon, yeah.
Was it Solomon?
Solomon.
Okay, Solomon. She came to Solomon to get some answers. Yeah, why are you so, how do you accomplish all this? Can anybody else do it? What do you do? All this great success that you have and accomplishments. And so like a king or a person will have to go far and wide to get the depth of God's understanding. But now that I've said that, should we work the Old Testament and New Testament together? Yeah, same time.
That's good.
Because Brother Williams definitely wouldn't read the Old Testament without balancing the New Testament. So, here we go. What did the Apostle Paul want? His prayer, Ephesians 1 and 1 and 17 through verse 19. It's good for God to, David says, to hide stuff, don't let it all out. A king will search until he finds it.
Mm-hmm.
That's, and back in that day, that's what they said. Now, in this day, let's parallel, see where we are, this redemptive reality. What does it say in verse Ephesians chapter 1, verse 17, 18, and 19?
That the Lord God, that the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him.
Mm-hmm.
The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that ye may know what is the hope of his calling, and what the riches of the glory of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power.
Okay, all right, praise God, that's good. So we see there that Paul is saying that you can, how do you know he says you can? Because Paul prayed to God that you and I get full understanding. That's what Paul prayed. So that's what he prayed. Over there, in the Old Testament, Solomon said it's good to God hide and touch.
Yeah.
Okay. So,
you know, it is still hidden from the natural man there. And the word says that we've been made kings. And so it is an honor. It's the honor of kings to search it out. The revelation comes as you search the scriptures and all. It just doesn't just fall upon you.
Okay. Okay. All right. Let's go read, finish up with verses 3. We'll read that.
The heaven for height and the earth for depth, and the heart of the king is unsearchable.
Okay, the heaven for height. The heaven for height is that. That's how far you got to go. to get the info. How far is heaven? Long, long way from here. Ooh, man, can we master that? The earth for depth. How much in the earth you want to search? How deep you want to search in the earth? And the heart of kings is unsearchable. In other words, you don't really know what's on the king's heart. And I'm going to parallel that king with the Lord, with God. Now, what I'm trying to get over to us is that understanding all that we ever want to know about God is not unattainable. It has been proven that God's creation can obtain and understand, have a know-how to do whatever that creature wants to do. But that's a little bit off our lesson, but that is reality. Man has proven it. Let's go to the moon. Did we make it? So you got to have some real correct knowledge to do that. You just don't wake up in the morning out of kindergarten and what have you saying, going to the moon this week. You got to have some real good knowledge of how to do that. That far reaches our normal understanding. How do you do that? How do you build something, a contraption that can go up there and take you back? Something you better pray. Yeah, I'm praying. Even back in the old days, man says, I'm going to heaven. I ain't waiting till I die. Who's going with me? Hey, I'll go. That's what they do. And what? Would have gotten there. You would have gotten there. So, what about God's creation today? Man. So, okay. Okay, now, here, verse 3 again. The heaven for height, the earth for depth, and the heart of king is unsearchable. Take away the dross from the silver, and there shall come forth a vessel for the what? For the fire. So, here he's saying that if you take away the stuff that keeps you from shining, it keeps you from being all that you can be, then you'll be a vessel. Whoa, what a great thing you would be. So what he's saying here is that take away the dross from silver. How do they polish with that silver? How do they make it the way it's supposed to be and keep it that way? How do they do it?
First of all, it has to be burned in fire to get rid of the dross.
To get rid of the impurities.
Then you have to keep it polished.
Then you got to keep it polished. If anybody got silver at home, you going to tuck in the drawer? Haven't looked at it too
much. Yeah,
have
it.
Yeah, it takes too much work to keep this. You got to clean it up. If you got real silver at home, you got to take it out of the drawer because it's going to start doing its thing. And you got to shine it up every time you go get it, even if it's a fork spoon or knife, because it's real silver. So, and then, oh, that's nice. That's the real deal there, man. And that's the same thing about mankind, is that if he takes away those things that gets in his way, oh, what a creature he'll be. So that's what we want to work on, is what's holding me back. Yeah, what's holding me back? There's a famous man that said, don't wish things were easy. Wish you were better.
You know, most of us don't want to go through the fire, though, because it's hot.
It's hot?
Yeah, oh, it's hot. And when I said the fire, I mean the trials of life and the different kinds of things.
Yeah, it's very
hot. We'd rather retreat because, you know, it's hot.
Yeah.
Not literally hot, but, you know.
Look at Proverbs 17:3 here. You got some Bibles.
The refining pot is for silver. And the furnace for gold.
But the Lord tries the hearts.
All right. Yeah, that's where we get short circuited. The Lord is testing the real you. What would you do if you had access to everything? If you had all knowledge and wisdom, understanding, you had it really going on, what would you really do? So the Lord, he's not going to test your heart after you have accomplished. He's testing the heart before you get to the thing that you're searching for. To find out what, okay, and then if you need some refining, you need some dusting off, polishing up, then that's the time for you to, you say, oh, I haven't attained, I haven't got what I wanted, all this like that, what's going on? It's time for you to start checking yourself for silver and start getting rid of some of the stuff that's holding you back. Because Paul said over there, I'm praying that you know the depth and the riches. I'm praying that you get it all, know it all. So our achievement is to, our effort is to shine up ourselves. It's something. That's all the way for, that's dealing with lies. How come I can't get this under control, this and that physical thing? Oh, something you need to do. What? You know, you the silver. Self-polished up. You know what the dust are. Now we're looking over at Jane and Susie across the room. This is you. This you is in your way. Okay, praise God. Verse 5 and 6, if you will.
Take away the wicked from before the king, and his throne shall be established in righteousness.
Okay.
Put not forth thyself in the presence of the king, and stand not in the place of great men.
All right, let's go. I think the author suggested that we look at 1 Samuel 13, chapter verse 13. There, he's scripture, verse 5, take away the wicked from before the king. And if you want everlasting, let me put it like this so it'll be simple for us, everlasting success. That sound all right, Sister Hill?
Sounds good, man.
Everlasting success. Some folks are one-hit wonders. Make a big splash, like a politician I know, female from Alaska. One-hit wonder. And, you know, you can't get a common sense, cohesive, comprehensive word out of it. Thank God for John McCain for picking me as my ticket. So if you want everlasting success, God said you can have it, but here are some of the to-dos. Am I right in 1 Samuel 13:13? Someone read that if you will, please.
And Samuel said to Saul, thou hast done foolishly, thou hast not kept the commandment of the Lord thy God, which he commanded thee. For now would the Lord have established thy kingdom upon Israel forever.
Okay. Because you're doing foolish stuff, you're not wise. Mm-hmm. This is, you've got some foolish stuff going on. You haven't kept the word of God, like he told you. Now would the Lord have established thy kingdom by now? Oh, so much wasted time. So much wasted time. Wasted time means that in the present, you can't do what you really desire to do because you have wasted so much time back in the past when you had opportunity to do it, when the timing was right. Wisdom has a lot to do with timing. The timing that you receive that wisdom, when do you actually go out and what? Act on that wisdom that you have received. And this king, he received it early, but he didn't do it. He just kept doing foolish stuff. Oh, you'd have had it by now. Woo! I tell this, you know, my classmates yesterday, at another reunion meeting. So we had the first one, so we knew it was going to keep going.
All right.
So, hey, I said, we only started with 4 months before August, trying to round up the missing in action, putting the word out that we're having these events. Yada, yada, yada. The last event we had, The door closed at 1 o'clock, Brother Al, can't get in. We have people paying up until 12:30 a.m. to get in. Then they said yesterday they gave a report of everything, took a survey, public liking it. Then one person said, well, tell me about the money. How did the money go? So the secretary got up and said that I was sweating bullets because we started with zero. And me and someone else had put our credit cards up before the actual money rolled in. And if it didn't roll in with the contracts that we had made for the venues that we were going to, guess who had money? I was praying bullets. Then she said, we paid everybody off that we contracted to do the events. And after 1 year, the first time out in 40 years for the class reunion, we have $1,100 in the bank after everything's been taken. I said, dang, what's wrong with you? Let's think if we'd have started 40 years ago. We'll have $100,000 in the bank. And then we could have a class reunion in Jamaica. Why we wait 40 years to get together? I can't even recognize that. So we had the wisdom and everything back then. We first got out, but we were messing around, kicked the can around. So, wisdom is good for you when you get it timely and act on it. Some folks don't act on it. They just, I know, but I ain't doing nothing. Circumstance, this, the other. Ain't done nothing. Come look up a little time later. You had it by now. That's what the scripture is saying here. We're talking Solomon's wisdom. You had it by now. Okay. Let's read verse 6 again. Put not forth thyself in the presence of the king, and stand not in the palace of great men. Look at Luke 14:7. He's saying there is that stop promoting yourself. Stop putting yourself into the favorable position. Yeah, I don't know. See here. Sister, if I go visit the hills, Sister Hill, y'all got a lazy boy or something like that at the house? Favorite chair or something?
Yeah,
favorite chair. Favorite chair. Yeah. Is it yours or Pastor Hill's?
It's mine.
It's okay. Go figure.
He's got his own.
He's got an ornery cloth on there. Hers. But, okay, if I came over just to drop in, talk to the hill, see what's going on, kill some time, make a chat for 30 minutes or so, and I look, still, come on in, brother. Okay, baby, now I'll go over there and I'll see that chair and sit down in it. What's Sister Hill's first thought?
I wouldn't think like that.
Yeah.
Now, if you're guessing my home, I'll make you welcome, and you can sit where you want to sit. Okay. Now, if you put your feet in it, that's
something. I didn't go to the refrigerator and see what's in here. Looking around. Just right in the middle of the conversation, get up and go to the refrigerator. And that's what the word is saying. This is what Jesus is saying. When you go into the presence of some place or somewhere, don't you take the best seat. Just because you know, don't be.